Case number 111987, Jonathan Delaney and Juan Apodaca v. Mark Wilmore et al.
May it please the court, if I could reserve 5 minutes for rebuttal, I'd appreciate that.
5 minutes is granted.
A brief factual background about this case. My client was a Riley County Police Department officer headed for an accident scene on what we call Bill Snyder Highway. He was headed southbound. He had been advised about 3:36 a.m. that there was an accident. He was headed at a high rate of speed with his passenger, another officer, toward the accident scene. What happened was he ended up striking a vehicle that belonged to the defendant, who was a drunk driver who had rolled the vehicle and left it parked in the lane of the highway, in the southbound lane. What the officer had planned on doing is turning around and getting into the northbound lane and heading back toward Manhattan, and there was a car there, a Good Samaritan bystander, who had parked his car on the west side of the road in the median, and he saw the lights of that vehicle and thought it was the defendant's vehicle. What he did later was he sued the defendant for negligence for causing the accident in the first place, his negligent and drunken driving, etc., and also for turning his headlights off after the accident occurred, and also for not turning on his flashers. The district court judge, Judge Hendricks in Topeka, dismissed the case expanding the firefighter's rule, which was formed in 1985 by the Supreme Court, which basically stated that the negligence that brings you to the scene cannot be later sued for if you're a firefighter at that time. Judge Hendricks applied that and expanded that to police officers. And that's what we're here about today, basically, is our argument is it should not be expanded to police officers, and the defendant believes the firefighter's rule should be expanded to police officers. That's basically a summary of the facts, and if I could go into my argument.
Certainly.
Okay, thank you. Two things I want to point out first is the Calvert court or case in 1985 expanded the firefighter's rule, basically just invoked the firefighter's rule. In that situation, a firefighter had went to a scene to put out a fire and had been injured by ammonia and had suffered significant injury and had filed a lawsuit for the negligent act that brought him to the fire in the first place. The Supreme Court at that time found the firefighter's rule should be applicable and adopted a public policy standpoint in doing so, not a comparative fault situation or anything other than good public policy at that point. What happened was the court set forth basically a standard that says if a negligent act occurs, you're a firefighter, you go respond to that negligent act, you can't sue the person who accidentally set their barn on fire or did some negligent act to bring you to the scene in the first place. And that's what the case in Calvert, the plaintiff, was trying to do. They did set forth several exceptions, which we'll talk about in a minute. We submit, and I got the case shortly after the judge, I wasn't the original lawyer, but right around the time of summary judgment was issued, I got the case. I filed a motion to modify or amend the judge's ruling, trying to bring up the fact that it was an intentional, wanton, or willful act that brought my client there in the first place. It wasn't a negligent act. I'm not sure the judge didn't really address whether that was procedurally improper, but he ruled that basically we lost based upon several different issues. Our first argument would be that it wasn't a negligent act that brought my client to the scene. The judge found that the defendant, Mr. Wilmore, had a 0.1 alcohol level, was driving under the influence of alcohol, and basically was driving in a willful and wanton manner when he caused the original accident. We believe the firefighter's rule itself only applies to negligent acts, and it should not apply to intentional, reckless, wanton acts. There is no law in Kansas. There's law all over the country.
You cited three cases, I think, counsel, on the expansion of the exceptions to include willful, wanton, reckless, right?
Yes.
What's your response to your opponent's arguments on those cases? I think he's got an argument on each one. One's from Michigan, right?
Yes. I did not study specifically each case today.
Okay.
So I'm not prepared to.
Well, the Mahoney case is out of New Jersey, where the rule's been abolished anyway, right?
Right.
And Randage, the Illinois case?
Yes.
Your opposing counsel cited several Illinois cases that didn't adopt the position of the Court of Appeals case cited.
Right.
And the Miller case out of Michigan, that was an independent tort by a third party that injured the officer, right?
Right. Different than this situation.
So do you have any cases that are closer to on point with your situation?
I cited everything in my brief. I basically came here to the standpoint today that there is no law in Kansas on the exceptions other than the Calvert case and the subsequent case. There's two cases in Kansas. And we don't think that Kansas should adopt the rule of law that an intentional, wanton, or reckless act, which is what was committed by Mr. Wilmore in this case, should be covered by the Firefighters Act.
Right. Explain the policy for your position. Why does that make a difference when the firefighter or police officer is responding to an emergency? The nature of the cause of the act that brought them to the scene.
Okay. Well, one reason is the person, the defendant in this case, is getting the benefit of the firefighter's rule, or if it's expanded to all emergency personnel, they're getting the benefit of that rule. And I understand if somebody negligently burns their own barn down or has an electrical fire or something like that and does something that's careless, not being able to sue them for something of that nature. But when a person is driving drunk and rolls their vehicle and 6 minutes later after the call comes in, the officer is severely injured, we don't think that protection should be given to that defendant in this case. The second thing is the exceptions themselves. We pointed out two different, and I don't think the exception, or I don't think it's an exception about the willful and wanton conduct. I just think it falls under the definition of the firefighter's rule, should only cover negligent acts, not somebody making a meth lab or doing something that's...
But I don't think you're answering the question. The firefighter's rule is there because firefighters are paid by the public in general to perform a job, and it's foreseeable that the house will be burning or that there will be an accident for the police officer, and that's what they're hired to do. So why does adding an exception, if the accident that's foreseeable that the officer will have to take care of was caused by the level of negligence that caused the accident, how does that fit into the public policy behind the rule that we don't allow a cause of action for someone doing what they're hired to do?
Right. Well, the public policy, what one of the statements in Calvert was, there's a firefighter's relief fund that pays disability benefits and it pays funeral benefits, et cetera, for firefighters, and it was discussed about the benefits that they get, and it's part of their job, and who ultimately gets protected in this case is not just the general public, it's
one
person.
I understand that argument of why firefighters can be distinguished from police officers,
right.
But that still doesn't answer the question why the firefighter's rule should be modified to add another exception.
Right. And my statement to that would be, that may be a reasonable thing to do, but I don't believe it should be done by the court. The legislature has found a way to enact one law after another over the last 10 years to almost eliminate workers' compensation benefits. I would be shocked that they hadn't considered something like this. I did not think it was appropriate for the judge to expand it to the police officers when it was formed in 1985. It did not say anything in 1985. The Supreme Court didn't say, well, let's apply that to all emergency personnel. That it was not done at that point. I don't know why the legislature can't do that. It's not been done. And maybe, you know, a consideration here is police don't have that same firefighters relief fund. And I'm sure all of you, if you've had, and I'm sure you have had workers' compensation cases come here, that's a consideration. In 1985, when this was enacted, there was an excellent workers' compensation system in the state of Kansas that compensated firefighters, compensated police officers for their injuries. Now, as a practitioner of workers' compensation, there are so many hurdles in there to getting any compensation. This eliminates, they barely get anything anyway, and now if there's a negligent or, you know, reckless or drunk party as a defendant, there's no way to get any compensation or very little compensation out of an accident, especially if they're an older police officer. And I won't go into all the problems with the Workers' Compensation Act, but that is a public policy consideration to look at in this case, which I pointed out at the Court of Appeals.
Did the legislature react to the Calvert decision?
I did not see any type of, it's not been codified. The firefighter's rule has not been.
Anything to be made of that inaction?
I would imagine if the legislature, at least today's legislature, could find a way to eliminate benefits for a firefighter or a police officer, they would gladly do so. So I would assume that they don't want to do so. There's been lots of archaic laws passed in the last session, since 2011, gutting the workers' compensation system. If firefighters or police officers are on the block, or if they had thought about that, that's something the legislature should do. In my opinion, not the courts, but the, you know, like I said, that's my public policy arguments. It's not the time when police officers and firefighters and all public servants and all employees in Kansas are under attack to throw one more thing at them. And what we're doing here is, like I said, there's two exceptions. I think this clearly falls under this person, and I can see the argument that There's another, I'm a cross appellee on this argument about the probable or about the proximate cause. This guy's on the way to investigate an accident. My guy admittedly commits some mistakes. He's going 100 and some miles an hour.
I don't think the proximate cause issue is before us today as a council. Wasn't in the petition for review.
Okay. No.
Yeah.
It was okay. In a court of appeals. But. Okay. Anyway, there's ways for this case to be disposed of outside of the firefighter's rule. There is also two exceptions to the firefighter's rule. There is the fact that the person whose vehicle is rolled over at the time of the scene shuts off his lights. That's a second act of negligence, and there is the judge believed that those exceptions require that those be done while my client was on the scene. We didn't read that language the same way from Calvert. The second thing is there is a hidden danger, which really isn't the exact same thing. I can give you lots of analogies for firefighters and for fires, but there's a hidden danger of a car sitting across the southbound lane, and the defendant, in this case, probably due to his state of intoxication, did not turn on his flashers. That's a second act of negligence that should be allowed to go in front of a jury that should get this out of the firefighter's rule or the expanded firefighter's rule if the court adopts what the Court of Appeals did. But basically, my client hits the vehicle, which he would not have hit if the person would not have likely hit. It would be a very good factual question for the jury if the defendant would have left his lights on instead of choosing to shut them off, or if he would have put his flashers on. There's evidence that the Good Samaritan or the witness who stopped had his flashers and had his lights on, and that's what my police officer who drives up to the scene too fast sees and ends up colliding very hard with the defendant's vehicle. But there's two acts of negligence after the original drunk driving rollover for which he's there. And we would analogize those to things like, again, the meth lab, the person who doesn't warn the firefighter that barn you're about ready to spray water all on has a lot of chemicals in there that don't interact with water very well, things of that nature. Or he moves things before the police officer gets there or the fire department gets there that are explosives, and then they end up causing severe injury due to his negligence or intentional conduct before the officer gets there. I think the court itself read the exception differently than we did, obviously, but I don't think it matters when you commit the subsequent negligent act. The two negligent acts done, one was a failure to act of turning the lights on and the flashers, and number two was turned his lights off for some reason, even though his vehicle is blocking both lanes.
Do we have any further questions? All right, thank you, counsel.
Thank you.
Good morning. Joel Riggs on behalf of the defendants appellees, Mark and Matthew Wilmore. May it please the court. I think that the issue in this case is pretty simple. As Mr. Fincher just addressed, it was should the firefighter's rule that was previously only applied or only had reason to come to before any judicial controversy was applied only to firefighters, should that be extended to law enforcement officers? I think the district court and the Court of Appeals properly determined that it should be as it is in many other states that have addressed this issue. Most other states that have addressed this issue, in fact, call it the public rescuer's doctrine, that anybody who's on the, yes, Justice Johnson.
Well, I've finished your thought.
Okay. That should apply to any public safety officer under a specific narrow set of circumstances that it should apply. And I think Judge Bruns asked a very good question when we were arguing this before the Court of Appeals, when he said, so if a firefighter would have come to this accident scene and done the same thing, he would be barred from recovery. But if a police officer coming to do basically the same function or similar function comes to the scene, he is allowed to recover. It's not appropriate. They're there for the same circumstances under the narrowly tailored firefighter's rule.
They're not there under the same for the same circumstances, though. That's maybe the difference between a firefighter and a police officer. Police officer's there to investigate a crime. Firefighters aren't there to investigate a crime except for perhaps the origin of a fire or something like that.
That's,
I mean, it's a different role and function. Which gets to the distinction between a firefighter and a police officer.
Justice Rosen, that's a good point, but in this particular factual circumstances, there was no knowledge that a crime had been committed or had there was any evidence of a crime other than that there was a motor vehicle accident. The Court of Appeals, I think, properly said, now the firefighter's rule and the way it's expanded herein only applies to a specific narrow set of circumstances. And we're not going to do it when we're talking about criminal investigations, but public safety functions is the only time that this is going to apply.
Counselor, you said this is a simple case, and to me it is a simple case for the very fact that the separation of powers doctrine would indicate that public policy is a legislative function. And in fact, 17 years after Calvert and O'Brien versus Columbia Insurance Groups, 274-572, this court, in an opinion by authored by Justice Lockett, took a panel of the Court of Appeals to the woodshed for making a common law rule based on public policy. And I quote, the declaration of public policy is primarily a legislative function. It is not the duty of courts to decide public law questions of policy affecting disputes of private rights and liabilities as a legislative function. And then subsequently, Justice Breyer said, we are not free to act on emotion or even our view of wise public policy. We leave the guidance of public policy through statutes of the legislature. That was the Higgins case in 288 Kansas. So I'm asking you, why is it the Court of Appeals function or this court's function to expand that when we've had decades for the legislature to expand it, and they haven't?
Well, Your Honor, I think that it goes to this court said, we're going to adopt this rule as a matter of public policy. So I guess in certain cases, they'll say, we're not going to act on issues of public policy. But in this particular case, the court did act and said, the basis of our decision is a matter of public policy, and we think that this should be the law of the state.
And so, you can argue stare decisis with regard to Calvert, but that isn't what you're arguing. You're arguing for an expansion, a new rule that makes a emergency provider doctrine instead of just firefighters. That's what you're asking.
No, I'm not asking to expand the public policy. I'm just having the public policy that has been adopted by this court applied equally to all people in similar situations. And like as Judge Bruns noted, there should be no distinction between these two groups. Just because this court has announced the public policy and they happen to call it firefighters, if they would have called it public rescuers doctrine at the get-go rather than firefighters, then there wouldn't even be an issue of that you've raised. And there's no reason to distinguish between in the way that the rule has been announced of we're only making this rule apply to certain public safety functions, not to every sort of conduct that any public rescuer is engaged in, but in situations like this one here, this is where it's going to apply. And there's no reason, based upon the reason the rule exists, why it shouldn't apply to this certain set of situations. I think if the legislature was going to act and say, we don't think this is good public policy, they would have struck down the firefighters rule or enacted certain limits or limited the scope and somehow, and they didn't. And they allowed the public policy that was announced in Calvert to apply. And if it applies in a certain set of circumstances, it should apply to a certain set of circumstances for all public safety officers that are engaging in the conduct that the rule is limited to, which
Counsel,
is public safety function.
The fact is that some states have done this by statute. Some have done it by common law rulings from the court. The doctrine originated as a common law doctrine, did it not?
I believe so, and then other states, have you said, have adopted it or kind of tailored it to fit certain circumstances.
Right, and so there's a patchwork of states who've done it by common law tort and some who've done it by statute.
Yes.
But tort law generally is mostly a creature of common law, is it not?
Yes.
Okay.
And this is
that's part of the reason that courts do make policy in the tort area where they don't make policy in other areas that are primarily superseded by statute.
That's exactly true. That's why the court acted when it did in 1985 in Calvert, because it has the authority to do so.
And counsel, what would be your argument to follow up on Justice Johnson's theory, I guess, that this court says this is a separation of powers issue and the Calvert court overstepped and we're just going to say this is the legislative function? So Calvert is overruled, and as a result, you would lose as well. What kind of response do you have to that?
Well, I would adopt just what Justice Breyer just indicated, that is within the power of the court to determine certain areas of public policy within tort law and common law, and this is a common law situation. If the Supreme Court is not going to chime in on this, which is part of what its job is to do, you should use your powers that are granted to you under the Constitution to do what you've been asked to do. And in this case, it's determined the common law within the state of Kansas.
And with that, opposing counsel indicated his work in the workers' compensation law. The issue of retaliatory discharge for exercising workers' compensation rights, that's something this court adopted in the early 80s. Do you see any similarity between what's being espoused today and that doctrine?
That the court can...
The court, as a matter of common law, can create, in that instance, a tort of retaliatory discharge because the employee was exercising their statutory right for workers' compensation. Does that have any bearing on the discussion today?
I'll leave that to the court as to whether it should apply or there's any sort of an analogy there. I would just assert that the court has the power to address public policy in the tort sphere, and the court has already indicated what the public policy should be in this case, and that we're not calling for an expansion. I think what you just indicated, what Justice Johnson's position was, I took it a little bit different. He said, we're not gonna take away Calvert because it's out there and the legislature hasn't done anything about it. I think what his argument was, let's not expand the rule in Calvert. And my argument in response to that is, we're not expanding Calvert. We're just addressing it to a certain fact situation under the law that exists in Calvert, and we're not expanding it. It's not, I don't think the court would be going beyond its
It's a different
powers.
Application. It's
yes,
the
sir.
Same doctrine, but a different application.
Yes, sir.
All right.
I was a little confused by the exceptions to the firefighters' rule. Particularly the third-party application. In this case, there were claims against for negligent entrustment, and those were dismissed out, as I understand.
Yes.
But had those claims not been dismissed out?
I'm sorry. Those claims were not dismissed out. I'm sorry.
Are they still here?
I believe that they were kind of subsumed under whatever negligence that led to the motor vehicle accident. With this firefighter's rule, would be all negligence claims would be barred by the application of the firefighter's rule.
So there was no discussion about third-party exceptions to the firefighter's
rule? Well, the third-party exceptions are when somebody outside the scope of the original set of circumstances, I mean, I think that the negligent entrustment claim, as the courts have addressed it, is you compare the fault of all the parties to the particular incident, and that would be what we're, the negligence that we're talking about in this case, and that would be subject to the application of the rule, the firefighter's rule. The third party exception talks about when other parties come in subsequent to the conduct at issue that gave rise to the public safety issue, and then so when people come in afterwards, that's what we're talking about. But if we're talking about the comparative fault situation at issue in this case, the firefighter's rule would bar any claim against anybody whose negligence led to the public safety issue, and that entrustment claim is under that. I just wanted to address the issue raised by Justice Beyer with respect to the exception that was sought to be added on by plaintiff in this case. I don't really know if it's really added on, because I think that you just look to the application of the rule, and the application and the rule says that the public safety officer should be prepared for all hazards which are known or can reasonably anticipate at the site of the accident or part of his job. So if you just look at the application of the rule, it kind of addresses the issue of whether willful, wanton conduct should be applied. And as set forth in our brief below with the Court of Appeals and also our supplemental brief, is I think it's pretty clear that you shouldn't. Well, some legislatures have said there are certain exceptions, like the arson intentional act exceptions. They call it the arson exception and whatnot. But I think that The courts that have specifically addressed this issue, like the dissent we cited in our brief, I think does a pretty good analysis of why the nature of the conduct that gave rise to the accident to which the public safety officer is responding should not be considered if your reason is the public policy should apply to prevent these certain circumstances because of the limited scope of the rule. But one court that did specifically address it, and I think it kind of just gives a better explanation of the reason for the existence of the rule and whether it should apply, and whether we have whether it should apply depending upon the continuum of conduct that led to the accident at issue, whether it's intentional all the way down to negligence. And the New Mexico Supreme Court, when addressing this issue, said we're going to adopt a two-prong test based upon the culpability of the conduct, et cetera, et cetera. And first one is, if it's just negligence, obviously it would apply. But the second one is, if there was reckless conduct that was the reason for the rescuer to respond, is that reckless conduct within the scope of risks inherent in the rescuer's professional duties? Where they don't discuss the degrees of fault, but just to look at intentional acts, I don't think are subject to the rule. And if we go into the reckless down to negligence continuum, they said we are going to apply the rule, but only in those situations where the public safety officer should reasonably anticipate these issues that he's been trained to accept.
So the New Mexico Supreme Court case, they said intentional conduct, clearly intentional conduct would be outside the rule?
I don't know if they specifically addressed that, but they were making a distinction between negligence and then aggravated negligence or reckless conduct.
Did you agree with your opposing counsel when he said that the Court of Appeals said this would not apply in the context of a criminal act?
Well, I think.
Or did they just say we're not going to decide that because it's not before us today? I forget.
I think that the Court of Appeals said we're not even going to address whether it comes into criminal investigation. We're only addressing this particular, I call this the archetypical example of where this rule would apply, where an accident happens and a public safety officer is coming to secure the scene to make sure that additional injuries don't happen to people on site or other people coming on the site.
Counselor, can I just clarify that Calvert discussed the common law, doctrines of premise liability, invitee, licensee, that sort of thing, rejected that as a reason, didn't rely on that common law, talked about the common law doctrine of assumption of risk that some courts had used and rejected that and said we're just simply doing this as a matter of public policy, not as a matter of common law.
The Calvert Court did do that.
Right. Not expanding or construing common law to make this doctrine fit within existing principles, but we're making a public policy rule. That's what they said.
They went through that analysis and showed how it can be applied under a premises liability doctrine based upon whether you're a licensee, which of course has been abrogated by this court in another case, that it doesn't matter what your status is upon the entrance of the land.
That's because the legislature has stepped into the area of with comparative negligence law and that sort of thing. That has the legislative enactments have rendered some of the common law principles inapplicable anymore, correct?
Yeah, the legislature can enter itself and pass new laws that affect previously common law doctrines, so that's true. My time is up. I'm going to address any other questions that the court may have. Otherwise, I'll sit down and stop bothering you.
I see no more questions. You have no further presentation. Thank you, counsel.
Thank you.
We reserve 5 minutes for rebuttal.
I likely will not use my entire 5 minutes, but I did want to say that public policy is your job if you're going to, if there is going to be such thing. I think that, or I'm struck that the legislator's job, I think that they're asking you, and what happened in 1985 was something that the Supreme Court decided to do, came up with a public policy. And I think it's, you know, the court's position at this point should be that it's a different era. 1985, I think Joel and I were graduating from high school that year. Different governors, several reasonable governors in a row, reasonable legislators, reasonable workers' compensation laws, reasonable benefits. That time period, this law likely seemed reasonable to the court when they addressed it. It's a different time period now.
Is it your position, Counselor, then, that this court just doesn't, we can't formulate or impose public policy at all?
I think, obviously, back in 1985 they could, and I'm sure you
My question is, can we now? What's your argument? Is that, it sounds like that's your argument, that this court doesn't...
I've always, since I was in law school up to now, believed that the legislature made the laws, and if there's, you know, the separation of powers, the court interprets the laws. I don't see it being a position of the court in this case, and I'm sure there are cases where you...
Well, let me just ask a really very basic question.
Yes.
Do we still have common law in Kansas?
Yes.
And a part of the common law is to decide the policy. I mean, isn't that public policy? Isn't that inherent in all common law decisions? Right.
I agree.
And so if we still have some common law authority, whatever that might be, you're not suggesting that we don't have that authority. We can't set public policy in the arena of common law.
What my belief is, the court interprets laws and at times sets public policy. But my belief is that, and you guys are obviously the court, I'm not telling you how to do your job or suggesting that, but my belief is that the legislature has chosen to set public policy, very ironclad public policy, against the workers of Kansas. They will never abrogate this current legislature, the Calvert decision, and I'm not suggesting that you guys do that, although it probably should be. But why make steps or take steps as the Supreme Court of Kansas to further injure workers when it can easily be done and is done by the legislature every session? Why expand that and utilize any public policy decisions in this case, given we're in a way different time period than we were in 1985?
Yeah, so your argument, I'm sorry,
go ahead.
Sorry. Just to clarify, it sounds like your argument is not you can't engage in this public policy making. Rather, it is, look, I think that Calvert is bad public policy, and I don't think that you should expand it. That's your argument.
Right. Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Is the firefighters' rule contrary to any legislative acts? I mean, we have a statute that sets forth that comparative negligence is a law in the state now, right?
Right. Yes.
Does the firefighters' rule contradict, or is it contrary to the comparative negligence law?
I think it takes a fact question out of the comparative negligence argument and basically says you can't sue this person, they're not part of it, which is done all the time with the Tort Claims Act, etc.
Well, does it make any difference on the propriety of our making public policy if it's contrary to the public policy that the legislature has made versus making public policy anew for some area the legislature has not occupied?
If I understand what you're asking, there's been many laws that get in front of you, ladies and gentlemen, in front of the Court of Appeals that you probably don't agree with, that you say, that's the policy, we're not going to change it. Otherwise, I think most of the Workers' Compensation Act right now may be gutted, but it's in statute, it's in law. And I've seen, like, for example, Justice Rosen on the strict interpretation of the law that was going on in the last several years before they got into the entire Workers' Compensation Act, where you interpret the law and you didn't put in your own opinions, you held it strictly to what it said. I don't know if that answers your question.
To follow up on an answer you gave a few minutes ago, I understood you to say that you believe Calvert is bad public policy, but leave it alone. And in this case, just don't expand it or apply it to these facts. Is that basically what you were saying?
Yes. Ideally, I'd like to abolish that and raise the caps and work comp and everything else I could ask for in my Christmas list today.
But your position today, yes, is leave Calvert alone. Just do not apply its rationale to our facts.
Right.
And the fact that distinguishes Calvert from this is that we're dealing with the police officer as opposed to a firefighter?
That's one of them. Yeah, one of the facts, yes.
And the other one was, this is not negligent conduct.
It's not negligent conduct, and there's several exceptions. But we have to, I'll give you a couple more analogies and then I'll sit down. Police officers arrive for domestic violence. They're called for domestic violence. A person shoots at somebody else, hits a police officer. He was there for domestic violence. He cannot file a lawsuit under this type of reasoning, in my opinion, against the person who shot the gun because he was there to break up a domestic violence situation. Police officer arrives at a house, a dog at large. He's there to, you know, get this, you know, rabid dog out of the neighborhood. He arrives for that purpose. The dog bites him. He likely will be barred from suing the homeowner. He's there to fight, you know, to stop crimes and stop things prospectively from happening and to investigate crimes. Lots of expanded duties over firefighters. Firefighters are there to put out the fire and stop it from spreading. There's two totally different duties. And if you look at the law of unintended consequences, there may be many more examples that I came up with, at least, as far as things that we didn't intend that the police officer can no longer make a claim for. And there are many cases out there where a person causes an accident, they hit a tree, for example, their car is in the middle of the road, and they're rear-ended by a third party, for example. That subsequent act is an intervening act that stops the causation, and the police officer or firefighter can't sue the person who caused the first accident. That's the comparative negligence and the proximate cause, common law, statutory law that's put in place that should remain in place.
All right. I think we understand your position. Do we have any further questions?
Well, just clarify then the question that was asked before the Court of Appeals. If a firefighter is engaged in a rescue, which firefighters do all the time, they respond to accidents,
right?
They would be excluded from under the firefighter's rule, where a police officer engaging in the exact same conduct for the exact same reason would not be?
That's what the Court of Appeals stated. I think in this particular case, the firefighter could have said, well, the guy shut off his lights. That's a negligent act that was subsequent to his original negligence. Number two, he didn't turn on his lights, his flashers, and warn once the danger was known. So those two exceptions would take me
out
of that.
So you would say the firefighter, there would be exception to that applying to the firefighter in this instance.
Right. And while I don't agree with the Calvert case, I do see that their public policy argument, or at least statement, was that there's this firefighter relief fund, and I read through the whole thing, and it provides for disability benefits, it provides for life insurance, it provides for, each insurance company has to participate and put in some amount of money that goes to the firefighters in this situation, which police don't have the same, is my understanding.
Counselor, would one possible distinction between the firefighter going to a scene and a police officer, there's been some talk about the foreseeable risk,
right,
and one would expect a firefighter to foresee different risks than a police officer.
Exactly.
And so the same rule might apply differently to different rescuers based on their foreseeability, based on their job.
Right. I think firefighters respond to fires and to rescues and other things. Police officers respond to stop crimes, investigate crimes, and there's a million different things that could be happening, especially in 2016 versus 1985.
All right. Thank you, counsel. Thank you both for your arguments this morning. Court will take this matter under advisement. We now